We're happy to introduce Reuven, who will be giving us the first talk this semester. Reuven Amitai is a Eliyahu Elat Professor of Muslim History in the Hebrew University of Jerusalem and studies the history of the pre-modern Islamic world and the adjacent areas. He's interested in the medieval history of the Turks and the Mongols, especially the history of the Ilkhanat, the Mamluk Sultanate of Egypt and Syria, the Crusades in the Levant and Muslim responses, the military history of the medieval world, Middle East world, conversion to Islam, late medieval Arabic epigraphy, and Palestine in the late medieval period. You have many areas of interest.
Yeah, that's why I have further thoughts on that.
From 2010 to 2014, Reuven Amitai was Dean of the Faculty of Humanities at the Hebrew University. From 2014 to 2016, he was Senior Fellow at the University of Bonn.
His recent and survived to tell the tale.
Oh.
Thanks.
Dean
and survived.
You're talking about the Dean?
Of course.
Okay, no. Maybe Bonn.
Bonn was easy to survive.
His recent publications include Holy War and Rapprochement, Studies in the Relations Between the Mamluk Sultanate and the Mongol Ilkhanat, 1260 to 1335, co-edited with Michal Biran, The Nomads as Agents of Cultural Change, The Mongols and Their Eurasian Predecessors, and co-edited with Christoph Kluz, Slavery and the Slave Trade in the Eastern Mediterranean, 11th to 15th Centuries, forthcoming. Today he'll be talking about some further thoughts on the Islamization of the Turks and the Mongols. Reuven, please.
Thank you. Good morning to everybody. I hope, Daniela, can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. I like sitting in the middle. I find it just friendlier and also easier to speak, and everybody hears me. As I warned, I'm a native English speaker from Philadelphia. I've been in Israel a long time, but that the accent still stays with me. And
true.
So if I am...
I say north in Philadelphia.
Yeah. So if I'm talking too quickly, just let me know. And certainly if I'm not talking strong enough, let me know. So first of all, thank you all for inviting me. It's a pleasure to come down to Be'er Sheva. It's to see old friends and to meet new people. I just can't commend this project enough, that this getting together and having a big comparative study of conversion and religious encounter, which obviously overlap over time, over space. This is one way, certainly one important way to approach the problem of conversion. I certainly don't have to convince anybody here how important conversion is for the study of human history in general, in the past, in the far past, as much as we can reconstruct it, and of course in up to the present and perhaps in the future. I think it relates to, and I'm sure this is also part of your discussion, to questions of linguistic and cultural change, which obviously are all interacted. But certainly the study of the Middle East, as I understand it, or the study of the Middle East since the time of the coming of Islam, is one of tremendous religious change, both from other religions to Islam and within Islam to certain various streams of Islam. So this is obviously for me it's a first of all pleasure to see you guys in action, but also to contribute my little talk. Now I will suggest that the role of the Turks and the Mongols, and I'll get into this a little bit more, their role in Middle Eastern history, in fact their role in world history, certainly the Mongols but also the Turks, whether it's East Asia or South Asia, the Middle East of course, Anatolia, and of course Eastern Europe and perhaps beyond, is fundamental for the history of the human history in the last 2000, perhaps even more. One can claim that there are people who perhaps spoke Turkish languages influencing the neighboring sedentary countries coming out of Inner Asia, coming out of the steppe, and influencing sedentary countries in East or West Asia and beyond, already perhaps 2,000, certainly 1,500 years ago, certainly before Islam, and certainly from the beginning of Islam. In fact, I would say, and I'll get to this a little bit too, that the interaction between the peoples of the Middle East and the ever-developing Muslim people of the Middle East, the ever-growing Muslim people, the countries that were established with Muslim rulers and Muslim law, and gradually over time becoming more and more Islamic in terms of demography, in terms of the general atmosphere, their interaction with the peoples of Inner Asia, the Turks and the Mongols, is crucial for understanding the history of this region. And again, we can go on and talk about China and India and other places too, but I'm going to be concentrating, of course, on the Middle East. I'm going to put the emphasis today on the Mongols. I'm going to tie it a little bit to the Turks in the 10th century. One could even go back a little bit. But actually, I decided once I made my commitment to come here and what was the title, and then I made another commitment to come to the conference in May, right?
Yes.
So I decided to split up the work a little bit, and I'm going to talk more in May about the Turks of the 10th century, and today I'm going to talk more about the Mongols. But that's enough too. Of course, I'm sure everybody here, even if you're not a medievalist, and even if you're not a specialist in Central Asia, and even if you're not an expert in East Asia or West Asia or Eastern Europe or whatever, everybody knows the importance of the Mongol period. Everybody knows that they certainly got around. They had a tremendous empire, perhaps the largest land empire of all times. Recent thinking, and I would say the last generation or so, it's becoming more and more clear. Perhaps the roots of this were already in place, but certainly in the last generation, it's becoming more and more clear to all scholars of the Mongol Empire, the Mongol World Empire, and its successor states, that in spite of the terrible destructiveness and the killing of the conquest, and there's no getting around that, that the Mongols did have a major role to play in politics and culture, in demography, in religion, and perhaps elsewhere too. And not all of it can be negative. Of course, negative and positive is a value judgment. But I think we can see certainly most of us would agree that interesting and important things happened under the Mongols in the realm of culture and politics, with influence for hundreds and hundreds of years throughout Asia and of course in Europe. I won't get into that today, of course, unless somebody wants to ask about that for the questions, but the study of the Mongols is certainly key for understanding much of the Middle East, certainly the entire eastern part of the Middle East, the Islamic world, the Islamic Middle East, from Iraq to the east to the other side to Uzbekistan and of course Anatolia. But I've also claimed, and I won't go into it today here, but one can't understand the subsequent history of Egypt and Syria without understanding the Mongols. If for no other reason, the Mongols, they've made such an effort in Syria and in Egypt to keep the Mongols out. And that was, in a sense, the Mamluks can only be understood, as among other things, by looking at their relations, their complicated relations with the Mongols. So the emphasis today will be on the Mongols. We're talking from the 13th, 14th century. And among one of the things, that great things that happened, was that the Mongols in Western Asia, and not only in the Middle East, eventually most of them became Muslims. So we'll be looking at that in general, and we'll be focusing in on the Ilkhanate, which is the Mongol state of the, I'll explain that a little bit later, the Ilkhanate, the Mamluk state of Iran, and it's Iran and it's Iraq, today's Iraq, and it's most of Anatolia, most of Turkey of today, and it's the Caucasus, and it's northern Afghanistan, and it's Turkmenistan. So all of that was ruled by the Mongols, beginning in the first conquest around 1219, and going on to 1335 with the breakup of the Ilkhanate, and then of course successor states, and then Timur comes, who can be claimed to be a Mongol too, though perhaps he spoke Turkish, but he was certainly of Mongol background and proud of his Mongol background. And so we're talking about generations of Mongol rule in the eastern and central part of the Middle East, and influencing way beyond that. And that's without taking into consideration, of course, the Mongols of southern Russia, the Golden Horde, and the Mongols of Central Asia, the Chagatais. And I'll touch upon them, but our emphasis will be on Iran and the surrounding countries. Now, when I say, maybe if you look at that interesting picture here, it's a beautiful picture, and it shows a Mongol drinking from a bowl, probably drinking fermented mare's milk, kumis, the kind of a beer. If you imagine something, a mixture of beer and yogurt, that's what the Mongols, people of Central Asia, like to drink, kumis. And I didn't bring the whole picture, I just took a detail, but it says, somebody had written in on the margin, Hulagu Khan. Hulagu Khan is the grandson of the famous Chinggis Khan, or Genghis Khan, and he was the actual founder of the real Mongol state around 1260, destroyed Baghdad, and set up the state in Iran and the surrounding countries. He was a mixture of a shamanist and Buddhist, and it says Hulagu Khan, but if you look carefully just to his left and down below, there's a turban. So evidently it's not Hulagu Khan, a Mongol has already become a Muslim, because no non-Muslim, no Buddhist or shamanist Mongol would be wearing a turban. So this is again the problematic. We have names that may be, you know, anachronisms. We have a combination of Central Asia and Islamic culture, and they interact, and of course they impact the Mongols, and of course, but like anything, you impact one side, it then reverses and also impacts the other side. So Islam changes The Mongols change, the people of Central Asia change, but in the end we have some type of amalgam, a complicated amalgam, and I'll touch upon that today. Now, there's an advantage to, say, the further thoughts. I'll get to this in a minute, but I've been on and off working on this for more than 20 years, perhaps 25 years. My original work was on political and military history between the Mongols and the Mamluks, and from there, of course, the issue of the Mongols converting, and how did that change the scheme of things? How did they present themselves? How did the ideological struggle with the Mamluks, who presented themselves as the fighters for Islam and against the infidels coming from the east, and that when both of them convert, that's an interesting matter in itself, which I will maybe touch upon today. But how did that happen? How did they convert? Why did they convert? Why actually to Islam of all things, since they played around with a number of other religions too? So I've been thinking about this on and off for the better part of 25 years, maybe even a little longer. I never wrote the book. I never sat down and wrote a book about it that I had thought to do. What I do is about every 5 years I edit another article. And there's advantages to that. There are obviously disadvantages. The advantages, of course, every time I think about it a little bit more and I read a little bit more and a new material comes out, and I'm going to give the names of some important scholars in a minute, and I read what they have to say, and I change. It's clear now that I have to change some of the things I wrote way back when, because the state of the research has advanced. Maybe I contributed to it a little bit, but there's a lot going on. So there is an advantage to coming to something every 4, 5, 6 years and writing another article and superseding to certain degrees things that I wrote before. I do want to mention some really great scholars who have done really, really important work. Charles Melville in Cambridge has done remarkable work. And Devin DeVise, who many of you know, has done also work mostly on the Golden Horde, but it has implications for the Mongols and conversion narratives and things like that. Judith Pfeiffer, who was just here last week, we had her for a week in Jerusalem giving some lectures, who just left Oxford to come to back to Germany. She got a professorship in Bonn, a Humboldt professorship, so she's been doing important work, which I haven't yet fully taken into account, and I will have to. And my colleague in Jerusalem, Michal Biran, who many of you know, has been doing also remarkable work on the Mongols in general and the Mongols in the West, and she combines Arabic and Persian with good knowledge of Chinese, so she has nobody else does that. Virtually nobody else has that ability to look at East and West Asia under the Mongols like Michal. And Michal has really established Jerusalem as a center for the study of the Mongol world empire. So all of these are the major figures, but there are of course others who've been writing about this too. Over the years, there's just a few of the things, the main things that I wrote over the years. So you can see 96, 99, 2001, 2004. Again, trying to put into the larger picture, trying to be informed by thinking about conversion. Perhaps not always successful, but at least trying. In fact, there's also, I'm going to pass this around. This is my recent book in 2013, which I come back to it. What I was interested in was more how the Mongols and Mamluks were relating to each other now that the Mongols become Muslims, and how does the whole ideological discourse change both internally and vis-a-vis each other. It's remarkable how that the Mongols convert and they adopt a Islamic discourse, but they don't forget their old discourse of Chinggis Khan and the right to conquer the world, and who the hell are these Mamluk slaves who think they can fight us, etc., etc. And the Mamluks, of course, turn to some of the learned people in the beginning of the 14th century, like Ibn Taymiyyah, the famous thinker, and they say, well, what do we do? They ask for a fatwa. And Ibn Taymiyyah gives them three fatwas. They say, well, what do we do? We used to fight the Mongols because they were infidels, and now they've converted. What do we do? Can we still have jihad? And Ibn Taymiyyah writes an incredibly learned fatwa, or fatwas, and he says he really, it's almost like a scientific inquiry as we understand it today, anthropological, and it's quite deep and well-informed. He, of course, met the Mongols and had conversations with them and their Iranian officials when they were visiting in Damascus in 1300. They weren't there on a vacation. They had conquered Syria and they occupied Damascus and most of Syria for 3 months, and Ibn Taymiyyah, who was basically had the leading civilian in the city, had an opportunity at length to talk to the Mongols. So he was reading and talking, and basically his picture was, these guys, they say they converted, but they really haven't converted. They do all kinds of things that they haven't, all kinds of weird things that they consider Chinggis Khan a prophet. They still follow the Yasa, the Mongol rule. And afterwards, there's a very interesting a wordplay, because Yasa kind of sounds like Si Yasa, politics or administration in Arabic. So they make that connection too. And it has lots of implications. What Ibn Taymiyyah says has lots of implications on Islamic thought until today, which I won't get into now. But it basically, Ibn Taymiyyah says, these guys are still pagans, jihad's still on the agenda. I found that remarkably interesting, and this is what I was trying to relate to here in this book. But I had an opportunity to go back and sort of summarize what's been said since I published that last article. I'll pass it around, you can have a look at it if you want. Okay, I just want to note that I haven't forgotten the Turks. I have one article which I will be coming back to. I say here, a rereading of Ibn Fadlan's Rihla, so it'll be a rereading of a rereading when I come in May. There's a lot less material for the Turks in the 11th century. We're really sort of fishing around in the dark, so to speak. Not that we have all the answers for the Mongols, but the situation is much better in many ways than regarding the Turks in Central Asia. I'll make a comparison in a second between looking at the Turks in the 11th century and looking at the Mongols in the 13th and 14th century. There are some things in common, and there are some things which appear to be different, and among the amount of information we actually have. Now, I made the point, and I want to make this point again. I think it's an important thing, how important the study of the Turks and Mongols, or if you wish, the peoples of Central Asia, the nomadic peoples of Central Asia, is, how important that study is for the study of the history of the Middle East. My great teacher, the late Professor David Ayalon, he had a scheme. Actually, this is an interesting story in itself. Ayalon wrote a lot, mostly articles over a long career from the 40s. Actually, his first articles were in the 30s, and he was writing until close to his death in 98. And he wrote a lot of very, very, Mr. Mamluk, in the sense he's kind of set up Mamluk studies. And of course, like today, we argue and we look at it carefully and we change things, but it was a remarkable scheme he created in general about the study of who the Mamluks were, what was military slavery in Islam from the 9th century onward to the 19th century. It's really quite remarkable. But most of these articles were very, very technical, very, very philological, which of course is worthy and a worthy thing in itself. But he had half a dozen or so very, very short articles, which were more like ideological or programmatic. He was looking at some of the big questions, and I, in my humble opinion, his most important article was published in the 1960s in a collection from Moscow of the Orientalist Conference in Moscow in the early. I can't imagine a more obscure place, and probably the worst printing ever in the English language. He published four pages about the relation between the Eurasian steppe and the Islamic world, and I think it's really his greatest article. It's the most important article. It doesn't always get the attention it deserves. And what he did was, I said, let's look at this complex 1,000 years of relations between the steppe and the Islamic world, and let's try to make some sense of it. And what he said, we have three stages, and these stages continue. It's not that one begins and ends, but rather it continues while the other stages are coming in. And the first, of course, is the 9th century. We're not going to talk about this at all, or hardly at all, but from the 9th century, they begin importing from Central Asia, from the steppes of Central Asia, military slaves, young men, and some young women, but men to be soldiers, women to be wives. And this is what we call the Mamluk, for lack of a better word, the Mamluk system. And of course, we can talk a lot about that. We're not going to do that today. About, can we talk about 1,000 years? How consistent was this institution? Ayalon claimed it was. He was following Ibn Khaldun there. I tend to agree with him overall. But it's clear the mainstay of Islamic armies are now from Egypt to the east, all the way into Central Asia. For hundreds and hundreds of years are mostly Turkish. At least they start off their career as military slaves, and at some point sometimes they're freed. But this whole idea of bringing hundreds of thousands, tens of thousands of young boys, and the girls too, to a certain degree, to the Islamic world, and training them and through the mechanism of slavery, is a mainstay. And with all the changes, one can see it into the 19th century with the Janissaries on the one hand in the Ottoman Empire, and the neo-Mamluk system in Egypt, both of which are eradicated, both of which have long overstayed their welcome, and they're eradicated in rather cruel manners in both Cairo and in Istanbul. But it's 1,000 years of an institution, which is pretty remarkable. So that's one stage. The demographic impact was probably not very great. It was important politically, it was important economically, it was important militarily, but the economic, the demographic impact was probably pretty minimal. Things begin to change in the early 11th century. From the early 11th century, we begin to see the influx of Turkish tribes, as tribal groups, into the Middle East from going through more or less what's today Uzbekistan. Coming through Bukhara, Samarkand, that area, into northeast Iran, under the leadership of the Seljuk family. There's sometimes some confusion between these two. The majority, these Turks were called Turkoman. There's some question about what exactly that means, but we know what it means. We don't have the literal translation, perhaps. The philologists, the Turkologists, are still fighting about what it really meant as a, literally, but we know what the intent is. The intent is to Turks who come into the Middle East not as military slaves. They maintain their pastoral nomadic lifestyle. They maintain their tribal formation, and they convert to Islam. Now that's the big question, which I will talk about in May. So I'll leave you in suspense. The process of how, in the step, this conversion process began beyond the realm of Islamic rule. Up till now, I think we could say that generally people became Muslims under the aegis of an Islamic state. Here we are going beyond that. Probably it has certainly happened elsewhere, but certainly in Central Asia, the initial movement, and it's a big initial movement, more or less in the 10th century, probably part of the 9th century, well into the 11th century, and then continuing on too as more and more tribes further away, mostly become Muslims. The process, and it's a big question, who converted them, how did they convert? Why did they convert? What did they do with their old traditional religion, their shamanistic religion, and all kinds of other elements? What did they understand of their new religion? What did they practice? What's the difference between the Turkoman, meaning the tribesmen, and the Seljuk family, which becomes much more institutionalized and adopts very, very quickly all the trappings of Islamic political culture and saw themselves as big preservers of Sunni Islam? These are big questions, which I'm hardly going to get into today, but it's a first big step. And the next step and the last step is the 13th century. The Mongols show up. Now the Mongols came into the Middle East. They went on a hike. They weren't on a visit. They weren't on vacation. This was a big deal. A lot of Mongols came in, much more than the Turks. They came in at least this first time, mostly the men. They didn't come in with when the Turkomans came. They came in with families. They came in with herds. They came in with tents. The Mongols came in as an invading army, at least for starts. Later on, there's an immigration from Mongolia of Mongols into the Middle East. But at the beginning, it's a large army under the direct command of Genghis Khan. Whereas the Seljuks and the Turkmen came in, and they were fleeing difficult climatic conditions, and they were basically being chased out of Central Asia. Once they got into the Islamic world, they became a conquering army. But as they were coming in, they're kind of looking over their shoulder, saying, "Who's after us? What's going on?" You know, they came in as Muslims, and they came in tens of thousands. The Mongols come in hundreds of thousands, at least 100,000 this first invasion, and they come in with a tradition of conquest. They evidently come in with an imperial ideology of world conquest. It may have been very much at its beginnings, but it's already there. Their cruelty, they weren't Muslims, and therefore they weren't connected particularly to the local population. They hadn't been living on the borderlands of the Muslim world, so they hadn't really gotten to know it. And they move into the Islamic world with a lot of, this is a 1219, it's a big mess. It's a lot of people are killed. A lot of destruction. Scorched earth. It's going to change, but it's going to take time for it to change. And so that's a big difference. But the Mongols, it's not just they come in and they do what they do and they go home. They leave some troops. And then later there's another wave around 1250. The 1250s is a second wave. And that's the wave that sets up a proper Mongol state that lasts for 75, 80 years, with successor states after that too. So it's a long process. It's not that they paid a visit, they did what they did, and they turned around and went home. They paid a visit, they left some of them, and they came back with more, and they set up states, and the impact is great. But of course, some of you are probably asking, so where are the Mongols today? What happened to the Mongols? We know what happened to the Turks. Plenty of Turks around. Where did the Mongols go? Where have all the Mongols gone? And it's a big question, and we can compare it, of course, to China. We can compare it to southern Russia. Well, I'll be getting to that in just a few minutes, but it's a big question. There are no Mongol speakers left in the Middle East, except there were some into the 1980s, there were like 10,000 of them, 1980s or 1990s in Afghanistan. There was a group speaking Mongolian. They had become Muslims, but God knows what happened to them in the last 20, 30 years. They've been blasted to smithereens, probably. But besides that, no Mongols left. Not in Iran, and not in Turkey, and not in Iraq, and not in anywhere close to us, anyway. So the Islamization of the Turks and Mongols, this is just some similarities and differences, I think, to put things in perspective, and then we're going to move on to the Mongols. First of all, both these processes of Islamization took place in tribal societies, which have a remarkable similarity to each other, at least in the beginning. In fact, some of the anthropologists and historians, I'm thinking of Anatoly Khazanov, who some of you know, I think his son here is a colleague of yours in Beersheva in the economics department. Anatoly Khazanov talks about continuity among the nomads of Central Asia, Inner Asia, from the time of the Scyths all the way up to the 16th, 17th century. A lot of similarity in culture, political culture, military techniques, traditional religion. I'm not going to get into that too much, but this is the role of the shaman. On the one hand, the belief in the Tengri, in the sky, which is actually also God. It actually works out better in Hebrew. I can say Elohut in Hebrew. How would I say that in English? The godness that's in the sky, embodied in the sky. And interestingly enough, for those of you who know modern Turkish, Tanrı in modern Turkish is God, same word. You watch a Turkish movie, Tanrım, my God, you hear that a lot. So that's the same word. So the role of Tengri is not the only god, but it's the important one. And Tengri also gives his mandate to rule the world. Now some of you are going to say, wow, that sounds like the mandate of heaven from China. And that's an interesting question that people have addressed. And the conclusion that I've heard, or at least I found most convincing, is that it may have come from Central Asia, actually, into China about 2,000 years ago, that idea of the mandate of heaven. So it may not be a Chinese idea influencing the nomads, but the other way around here. The Mongol army contained many, many Turks. In fact, the majority of the soldiers may have been Turks. There were Turks in the Middle East who got caught up. Turks in the Middle East were already Muslims, which is already an indicator of what's going to happen. They brought in, I cannot for the life of me separate, it's not always clear where the Mongols stop and the Turks begin. It's certainly, and even in Mongolia proper, which wasn't called then Mongolia, and the Mongols were just one tribe among many groups speaking Mongolian, or evidently speaking Mongolian, but it's not at all clear the interface between them and other groups, Turkish-speaking groups. The languages are related. There's an ongoing discussion among linguists about do they come from a common origin, or they just influence each other for thousands of years, and that's evidently what most people think. Certainly a lot of words are in common. Certainly many people were bilingual. It's not at all clear, but there are a lot of Turks came in with the Mongols, and then of course there are Turks coming in after the Mongols. There's this continual, I don't know if it's a flow, I don't know if it's a drip, maybe on and off it's different, but more people coming from Central Asia all the time in the aftermath of the Mongols, the majority of them being Turkish speakers. We probably have in both cases, and we're going to see that a little bit today with the Mongols, and I'll get back to it when we get to the Turks at my later appearance, but a hybridity of old and new. It's not that they adopt the new religion and the next day they've forgotten everything. They send all these shamans home and that's the end of that. It's clear that there's hybridity on different levels, including in royal circles and in elite circles. What's clear also is that these new Muslim rulers, whenever they adopt Islam, and with the Seljuks that was quite early on, before they actually came into the Islamic world, with the Mongols it's going to be about 1300. Towards the 1300, whenever they accept the new religion, they very, very quickly, I would almost say immediately, accept ideas of political legitimacy, Muslim political legitimacy, culture in general, administrative culture in general. They project themselves as being good Muslim rulers as they understand it. And I find that very interesting. With the Mongols, at least, they combine that with some older ideas, too. I find that remarkable also. They see absolutely no contradiction with that. And just to give you an example, in 1300, when the Mongols occupy for 3 months, they occupy Damascus. And they're ruling most of the city. The citadel holds out. Mamluks are in the citadel and holding out for 3 months. It's a very interesting story. Supposedly, according to their major historian, Rashid ad-Din, who I'll talk about in a little bit later, Rashid ad-Din records, he's there too, that Ghazan is talking, the Ilkhan Ghazan is talking to the notables of Damascus. And he begins to tell them that, who are your rulers? says, Kalaun, he's a sultan. He says, who the hell is Kalaun? He says, well, he was, started off as a slave. And Ghazan laughs and says, he's a slave? This is who you follow? What about us? What about me? And they look at him, they say, wow, yeah, that's right. You're the great-great-grandson of Genghis Khan. Wow, we didn't think about that before. Thank you. So the Mongols are coming and say, they're good. He presents himself as the Padishah of Islam, as the Emperor of Islam, but he's also the great-great-grandson great-great-great-grandson of Genghis Khan. That's no less important. That charisma that came from being Genghis Khan and all that Genghis Khan has done and all that his descendants have done around the world, and the idea, at least in theory, of world conquest, no less important. So I find that extremely interesting, and we'll touch upon that later. Now, there are differences. There are some differences, and of course, which limits the applicability sometimes to apply what we understand about the Turks to the Mongols and vice versa. The Turks got converted in the steppes, in small tribal groups. We don't know exactly how that happened. I tend to relate this, I attribute great importance to merchants, to Muslim merchants who were wandering around there. The Mongols had already moved into areas of sedentary civilization. They came in as a large empire they were a conquering people. The Turks in the middle, in the Central Asia, were small groups who were pretty much local chieftains. Maybe there were some very, very vague prince or king who was in charge. So they came in a time, they were converted at a time of political weakness. The Mongols at a time of rule, the height of their rule. We know much more about the Mongols than we do know about the Turks. So we can apply from one side to the other, but we have to be aware that we should apply it carefully. And as I say here, the agents of Islamization were not quite the same. There's more importance to the Sufis under the Mongols. I'm going to talk about that, to the mystics. They're not the only people, but they certainly play an important role. I don't find any Sufis in 10th century Central Asia, period. That's basically my thesis for my talk in May, period. No Sufis, none whatsoever. Nada. Yok. Whereas lots of merchants, some ulama, occasional officers, but Sufis, yok. So that's a big difference. That's a big difference. And I think that's one of the important insights of the last few years. I'm not the only person to say that. But anyway, we'll be concentrating on the Mongols anyway. And we'll be finding, among other things, we'll be finding some Sufis. Okay, and that's what got one of my changes, because I had kind of downplayed the Sufis in earlier work, and I'm now understanding perhaps it's a little bit more important. So today we're going to concentrate on the Mongols of the Ilkhanat. Khan is, of course, king or prince in Mongolian, Turkish and Mongolian. Of course, today every other person in Pakistan has that name as a last name, but at the time it was something significant and it was not taken lightly. The overall Khan, the great Khan, he could be called the great Khan. In Arabic, they sometimes say Khan al-Adam, but it's called the Kagan, which is various pronunciations. Hakan, and sometimes we see also. Ilkhan, Il is a Turkish Mongolian word meaning submission, peace or submission. And of course, in the Mongol political, what's called the political science of the 13th century in Mongolia, submission and peace were the same thing. The only way you could be in peace with the Mongols was to submit to them unconditionally. Now, this has been understood in the sense that the Mongol Khan in Iran and the surrounding countries, Hulagu and his successors, were submitted to the great Khan in China. They were brothers. Kublai was Hulagu's brother. And this was kind of brought them closer together, as opposed to other members of the Mongol ruling family, which came from other branches of Genghis Khan's descendants. We don't have to go into this, but you should know that Ilkhan is the way we apply, Ilkhanat is the way we apply to this large polity that rules from the Euphrates on the one hand to the Oxus River on the other, and from the Indian Ocean in the south all the way up to the Caucasus and the Caspian Sea and the Black Sea. So this is a big political unit, and it's referred to by modern scholars as the Ilkhanat. Now, grosso modo, if I could sum up in 30 seconds, a minute, what goes on among the Mongols in the process of more or less a century of their rule, I would say the following. I think I'm on firm ground when I say the following. The majority of the Mongols, and probably a good chunk of the Turks who came in with them and were serving them, the elites and the tribesmen remain nomads of one sort or another. We don't see a process, certainly well into the 14th century, we don't see a process of sedentarization. That doesn't mean no Mongols didn't sedentarize, didn't settle down, but it seems the vast majority of the Mongols remain nomads of one sort or another. There's a process of Turkification, meaning the vast majority, if not all, the Mongols become Turkish speakers. They get absorbed into the, again, this sort of, the Mongols are like an island, or islands in a sea of Turks. They find Turks. There are Turks, thousands and thousands of Turks living in the Middle East, already Muslims. They come in with Turks, and they're followed by Turks. And as I said, even some of the original Mongols, it's not clear that they were actually Mongols and not Turks. And in fact, there's a lot of confusion in the Arabic and Persian sources too. Ibn al-Athir was one of the early writers writing. He died in 1331, I believe. He's writing about the first Mongol conquest. He's hysterical. I mean, he's sitting in Mosul, and he's watching the Mongols are getting closer and closer and closer. He's like writing in real time. We couldn't do any better. It's like CNN reporting. And he says the Mongols are a type of Turks. So in the Muslim mind, at least, Muslim-educated people, historians and others, they're all kind of the same race, if you wish. In fact, that's the word that's used, jinns. They're associated to be part of the same race, the people of Central Asia. So the majority of the Mongols evidently become Turkish speakers. That doesn't mean that some didn't become somewhere Persian speakers and some didn't become Arabic speakers in the West, but it seems that the vast majority of Mongols did become Turkish speakers. And the vast majority of Mongols became Muslims, especially towards the end of the 13th century. And this is a complex and long, drawn-out process, which I'm going to talk about a little bit more today. That's the main theme. I would like to suggest as kind of a convenient, simplistic, but I think it works, explanation. One could understand the conversion of the Mongols to Islam in the Middle East as part of their process of Turkification, and one could understand the process of Turkification as part of the process of Islamization. There are two processes which are working and interacting with each other. Okay. Now again, I could say that and go home, grab a coffee and go home. But I'm not going to say that because, first of all, it'd be too short. Second of all, it's a good model. It looks good. It sounds good. It's catchy, but it's not enough. We have to understand better. I'm going to try to understand better as the next half hour or so. Now, one of the things I learned early on in my career, my first job at the Hebrew University was working in the geography department, and I worked there for 2 years. I met a lot of friends. I like to see myself as geographically informed, but I learned you always have to have a map. So here's a map. And this gives us an idea of the various political formations, the important political formations in the middle of the 13th century into the 14th century. We see, of course, smack in the middle, the Ilkhanat, which, as I said, today would be Iran and Turkmenistan and much of northern Afghanistan, north and western Afghanistan, Iraq, all of Iraq, modern-day Iraq, much of Anatolia, the Caucasus up to Georgia and Armenia and whatever, up to the Euphrates. That's the area, that's the frontier where the 60-year war between the Mamluks and the Mongols was going on. You see at the bottom here, the Lesser Armenia, there was an Armenian kingdom there that was a vassal to the Mongols, and they suffered accordingly because they betted on the wrong horse, and the Mamluks gave them a hard time afterwards. The Mamluk Sultanate, which I haven't very exact borders, but you get a pretty good idea, running up to the Euphrates, controlling northwestern Arabia, including Mecca and Medina, and of course Egypt was the heart. And to the north, we see the Golden Horde, which is another Mongol state, controlling the Slavic populations of what's today Ukraine and western Russia. We see the Chagatai Khanate, which is basically Uzbekistan and part of Kyrgyzstan and part of southern Kazakhstan today. And over all the way to the east, which is the Sultanate of Delhi, which is an interesting story in itself. It's very interesting to think that around the same time we have two Mamluk states. We have one in Egypt and Syria, and we have one in northern India. And there's a certain similarity between them. It hasn't never quite been solved how that comes about around the same time, but obviously it's not a complete coincidence. So what I've done, and this is expressed in the book, but I've taken it further, and I thought about it, and I rephrased some of the things, and it's clear that I have to change certain things as time moves on. My thinking evolves too, and I make mistakes, I have to confess. I made one mistake, or I didn't give enough emphasis to something, and I'll talk about that. I have a number of thoughts, part of which I'll read, and part of which I'll sort of summarize, and you can read along if you wish. So I call them some tentative thoughts about the conversion of the Mongols in the Ilkhanate. There's six or seven of them, and then I have a number of three or four passages. I'm not sure how much time. How are we doing here?
We're doing
Okay, 20 minutes? Half an hour?
20 minutes.
Okay, so I'm going to have to do this quickly and at least read one or two of the sources. I get carried away here. So again, as I said already, the Mongol army in the Middle East had a lot of Turks in it, and many officials there were soldiers, officers, officials, those in the Middle East were probably all Muslims, and they've been around for a while, and we find Turks, clear Turks, who had been serving other kings, other rulers, joining the Mongols early on and serving them. So I give the example of Husam ad-Din Kushlu Khan, who was a commander of a Mongol force that fought in Palestine in 1260, took the city of Nablus, by the way. So I would think that the Turkish officers and soldiers, together with mostly Persian-speaking bureaucrats, Muslim bureaucrats and Muslim scholars and mystics who surrounded the Mongols, had a great impact on the, they were the conduits, they were the context through which Islamic culture, the Muslims were acquainted with Muslim culture. It doesn't mean they were officiating at the conversion ceremony, but that's part of the larger picture. We can't forget that. Turks, Persians, Muslims, of various types, Turkish officials, Persian officials of the highest rank, and of course, learned men, both ulama and Sufis. Okay, we have some Mongols being converted early on. We have some examples, not a lot of examples. I'm going to read this example from Baibar Zamansuri. I just have to say the Mamluk sources have not yet been used enough for the history of the Mongols in general. The Mamluk sources written in Syria and Egypt in Arabic, I say we've gone beyond touching the surface. I think that's been one of the important things of the last generation, last 10, 20 years. I have to say that this is a Jerusalem contribution to Mongol studies, the use of the Mongolists that were reading Persian at best. They certainly weren't reading Arabic as well as they should have. And of course, the people reading Arabic didn't care too much about the Mongols. So, but we've now, that's been partially, I think, filled in the last 10, 20 years in Jerusalem. And a number of our students are doing it now. It's really kind of an interesting phenomenon in itself. So I'm not going to give the examples because we're going to get to them towards the end. But there are examples early on, even before 1260, of Mongols converting to Islam as individuals. Okay, now Sufis. This is a big question. Sufis can be counted. I'm going to read this. I think it's important. Sufis. I put on my glasses and read it. Sufis can be counted among the agents of Islamization of the Mongols, both the elite and the common tribesmen. Regarding the rulers, we can mention the role of various Sufis who were portrayed as somewhat disreputable in the sources. And this is an early Mongol Khan, Tegudur Ahmad, who converted in 1282, and he was a terrible ruler, and he was removed by 1284. He was surrounded by all kinds of questionable characters of Sufi, and that may be one of the reasons why he was hated both by the Mongols and by the Muslim officials who surrounded them. But 1260, 1295, we get Ghazan converting. Another generation has gone by. The man who actually converts him is a Sufi sheikh, Sadr ad-Din ibn Hamuya. There are stories from the Golden Horde of being converted by Sufis. What I would like to suggest is we shouldn't go overboard. The Sufis play a role. They play an important role, but they're not the only people there. The role of the Muslim Iranians, mostly bureaucrats, but also learned men, in this mutual process of acculturation, because it's not just one way or the other. And of course, this includes the Islamization of the Mongols. It was clearly demonstrated in the mid-1990s by the late work of the, by the work, important work of the late Jean Aubin. And we're going to see that example too. If we have time, we're going to read an example where the Sufi converted Ghazan, but the guy who set him up for it was his chief commander, who was a Muslim, a Turk who was his chief commander, and so it's obviously not, to say it's just Sufis is not enough, to say it's just Turks, it's not enough, it's obviously there's a lot going on, okay? Now, as I've said, I'm beginning to attribute more importance now to the Sufis than I did 10 years ago, and perhaps the final version, or the next version of my paper, or the next installment will be that. So here we go. Something which I still agree with, and I think is, I'm going to say very forcefully, I'm not sure everybody's going to agree with me, I'm not sure. I do not claim, I'll say it the opposite way. I claim that if the Sufis have appeal, it has nothing with a so-called similarity with shamans. They're two different things, two different worlds. There's no theology in shamanism. It's very, very Heisig, the great scholar of Mongolian religion, called it practical magic. There's no uniting with God. There's no destruction of the personality. shamans were professionals whose job it was to talk to the sky and talk to the spirits and get practical advice. There's not mass mysticism of people trying to have a mystical experience. So this is already, I said it, and Ahmed Kara Mustafa said it, and Devin DeWeese said it, for, you know, that this is something that's a misnomer. It all goes back to two great scholars, two very, very great scholars among the founding fathers of Islamic studies, Koprolu, the Turk, the founder of modern Turkish, the modern history in Turkey, and the great Bartold, V.V. Bartold, who understood this as being, what they did was they took, there are certain places where Sufis play a role, but we don't see that, and they said they associated this with shamanism. I'm sorry, I don't see it, and I'm going to say I hope this axiom of Islamization studies, at least with regard to the peoples of the Eurasian steppe, is on the way out. And I can expand on that. I'm sure there'll be some discussion of that perhaps later. Now we get to Ghazan Khan, who's the kind of the pièce de résistance here, and the Ghazan Khan, the elite in general. There's clear evidence that this was preceded by Islamization of tribesmen. It's not top-down, as is often suggested. Even Khazan, the great Khazanov, you know, again, one of my teachers, and a man I have the greatest respect for, suggested in his earlier work that this was top-down. We're finding evidence it wasn't the case. There were pockets, and more than pockets, of Mongols beginning to convert. Officers and tribesmen early on, and we're going to read the passage. But I just want to know: Bahi Breas in his Syriac history says that the army of Baidu, that was Ghazan's opponent, another member of the royal family, both the nobles and inferior folk in their entirety had converted to Islam. And that's why Baidu himself considered converting in order to get their to enjoy their support. And the Armenian historian, what am I doing here? Lost control. Okay, Hetum, the Armenian historian who writes actually in the papal court in Europe, but he says, writing in old French, he says that in the struggle between Baidu and Ghazan, those tending towards the law of Muhammad left the former's army and went over to the latter's army, who had recently become a Muslim. So there is some evidence. There's some evidence, and if that fact is if there's a political reason, it's to get the support of the Mongol tribesmen, who for different reasons are becoming Muslims. Okay, so now I'm following here Melville. If there was a practical reason, it was that influence of the Mongol ruler to adopt Islam. It was related to internal Mongol politics. And Melville writes that if a worldly motive is needed to justify Ghazan's conversion, it was the need to secure the support, okay, not of the Persian Muslim population and his future subjects, who hardly counted in the balance. I think that's very important, the balance of forces between himself and Baidu, and not in the political calculations of either, but rather the backing of the Mongol leaders and their troops who had already embraced Islam. And I'm going to say it even more explicitly. There is no evidence of which I am aware that Ghazan or the Mongol elite or the rank and file were motivated to convert to Islam by a desire to receive some type of legitimization among the Persian-speaking Muslim population over which they ruled. This runs counter to much of what is said. But there's no proof of it. I find no evidence that even didn't concern them in the least. They were concerned about legitimization among the Mongols, among the Turks, vis-a-vis the Mamluks, who were also Turks. They couldn't have, I mean, they basically were ruling by power, by diktat. Once they convert, that changes dramatically. And at the time of the conversion with the Mongols, the Yohan at their head began employing a whole array of Muslim symbols and other forms of traditional Muslim modes of expression to win legitimacy. Okay, things dramatically changed. And I would also say that perhaps the Islamization of the ruling class brought about a certain, I don't want to exaggerate, transformation and attitude towards the ruled. But again, we can go into that in the discussion. And as I said, how the Mongols now present themselves towards the Mamluks. They're a great opponent. For 40 years, they've been knocking the stuffings out of each other over the border, and the whole discourse is now going to change. Now, finally, my last comment here. As to be expected, the Islamization of the Mongols, and it doesn't matter if it were the elites and the ruler, or the common tribes, and obviously it was not cut and dry or a quick matter, but it was a long, drawn-out process. And we're finding plenty of examples that year after their formal conversion, there are all kinds of remnants of Mongol culture, Mongol political legitimization, Mongol religion, if you wish, that are still around. Shamans are still around. They've become Muslims, and the shamans are still waiting to be, they can be called, and there are examples, a generation after they convert, the shamans are called for reserve duty, if you wish. They're called from the barracks, so to speak, and they're called and they have to give some explanations about some natural phenomenon. And I give some examples here. There's a Ghazan participates in all kinds of Mongol traditions. Why he calls himself Padishahi Islam. He sees no contradiction. Same thing under Ojaitu, his brother and successor. Now, just last week, Judith Pfeiffer, I heard talked about this hybridity at some length, and it was remarkable. It was just remarkable. Rashid Adin, the historian, the contemporary historian, and also the wazir, a convert from Judaism to Islam, in her, this will be in her forthcoming biography about statesman, historian, polymath about Rashid Adin, he gives expression to the discussions that the Mongols are having. They're trying to figure things out, and he's recording these in his letters. His short books, he's recording some of these discussions. The Mongols are asking questions, practical questions. How do they resolve the conflict between their previous religion and their new religion? It's very, very interesting. Now, in the next few minutes, I don't know, 10 minutes or so, this is what I had. I brought four passages. I have two contemporary accounts in real time of the Mamluk sources recording to change the conversion of the Mongols and what they see, how they understand it. And then I have two conversion narratives. I think I'm going to read one of the first one is relatively short, and I'll read that. And then I'm going to jump to one of the conversion narratives, which I'm showing here for the first time. So this is perhaps the newest thing I'm showing here. I have read it, of course, a dozen times, but I never really paid attention to it, and I've just recently been able to pay attention to it. So this is what I'm going to... Sufis in action. So this is one of the things after reading this. I've read this, again, 30 times, 40 times, 50 times, and I just now just kind of fell into place. So in the year 681 Hijri, which is 1282-83, now this is a very important date because it's a year or two before, it's around the time of one of the great battles between the Mongols and the Mamluks in Syria. The Mamluks are successful. The Mongols are kicked out, defeated yet again. Big battle. It was nip and tuck during the battle, but the Mamluks won out. It was probably the biggest battle the Mamluks ever waged, and the Mamluks for another generation to keep the Mongols, the large Mongol army out of Syria. The ruling Khan, Abaka il Khan, is about to die. He'll be dying very, very shortly. We don't know that yet, but it's going to happen. Soon his brother Teguder is going to take the throne for 2 years, and he's already converted to Islam, so he becomes Teguder Ahmad. But he's a terrible ruler, and he gets kicked out, probably also because he became a Muslim, and that didn't help. The Mongol leadership wasn't ready for that yet, but he was a terrible ruler and a terrible politician, and he go on and on about that. But so this all happened just before that. All that's going on. So, and this is a direct quote. This year, a person from the Oiras are a Mongol tribe, named Sheikh Ali. Okay, he arrived at the royal court, the royal Mamluk court. He had converted to Islam, and he served the sheikhs, and he delved into the methods of Sufi devotion and withdrawal. The spiritual stations of the fuqara, the Sufi mendicants, were revealed to him. Okay, I can correct the English here. A group of Mongol youths, min aulad al-Mughal, and that's interesting too, because Mughal, usually the word in Arabic and Persian for Mongols is Tatar. When they use Mughal, which is the Turkish pronunciation of Mongol, it usually means these are the real die-in-the-woods inner circle of Mongols. These are not just people working for the Mongols, Turks who work for the Mongols. This is the real thing. So a group of Mongol youth, min al-aulad al-Mughal, followed him. He went with them into the country, into the Yohana, into Syria, and then to Egypt. They made obeisance before the Sultan Kalaun. He treated them with honor. Among them were Alakush, Taimur, and Umar, three brothers, and Chuban. Kalaun appointed them to the unit of his elite Mamluks. Afterwards, they got into trouble. He threw them all into jail. They didn't have a good end. I don't know what exactly they did, but they weren't behaving properly, and they didn't end nicely, as we say. But for the time being, very nice. So I got to say, this is, of course, one story. I don't know how many youths were there. It's not indicative. Can we say it's indicative? I don't know. But it does show that the Sufis are involved. It does show that somehow the mechanism of Sufism is one mechanism by which some Mongols became Muslims. So I can't, you know, obviously we can't generalize from that, but it's certainly the red light is flashing. The red light is flashing. There are other, I'll give other examples of other types of mechanisms, but certainly Sufism is one of them. Okay. One second here. Okay, yeah, I'm going to give this too. This is an important. I have another 5 minutes or so. Okay. Now this is already going. I think actually, one second, please. Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay. This is the report from Sadr al-Din Ibrahim ibn Hamouya, an important Sufi. Very important Sufi, a very important Sufi family. His father was very well known. He reports the story himself. He's in Khorasan now. He's in northeastern Iran, but he's going to make it to Damascus, and he's going to report the story himself. So maybe he exaggerates, maybe he changes things, maybe he makes things up, but at least it's not going through a whole process of transmitters. And he's reporting it to Birzali, who's a very, very important Mamluk historian. Okay, so this is what he's reporting. He, in fact, and this is what's even more important, he's the guy who actually converted Gaza. He's the guy who did the Shahada with him. He didn't set the stage, so we got some important information, but this is what he says. A number, Jama'ah, of the Mongols and their officers had already become Muslims before him. Okay, this is sort of setting the stage. And his wazir, Nauruz, was Muslim. Nauruz was not just wazir, he was the chief officer. And it's an important family. His father was very, very important. They had been serving the Mongols for 60, 70 years. He, Nauruz, knew by heart many histories and sayings of the aesthetics, prayers and stories and such like. So there may be a Sufi connection there too. But he's not a Sufi. He's a Turkish officer. He was of Turkish origin, but he knew Persian. That means he's been acculturated. Okay, and he was this is also important. He was the husband of Ghazan's paternal aunt. So he's related to the Mamluk royal family, he's related to the aunt of Ghazan, okay? Together they were agitating for the king's conversion to Islam and had talked about it among the army. So this is what's happening, people are talking about it, okay? I met up, me, Sadr al-Din, I met up with Nauruz, who talked to me, and he discussed with me Razan becoming a Muslim, said, he has already talked about this, but I am not sure of him. Perhaps God will smooth the way for him through your presence, so take your time, stick around, we're in for some important action, it's coming up. So again, we see some of a Sufi connection, but that doesn't explain everything. We see family members who become Muslims. We see close associates who become Muslims. We're not sure how it happened, but we see lots of Mongols, I don't know how many, 10%, 12%, 14.5%, I don't know. But a large number of Mongols have already become Muslims, and it's not just the tribesmen, it's also officers. There's kind of a groundswell. This is very, very interesting. It kind of reminds me, you know, I'm sure many of you know this, you know, there's Rodney Stark talking about the conversion, Christianization of the Roman Empire. He talks about networks. You know, one friend brings another friend. That's how things work. He found it with the Moonies, and he was suggesting that was also with the early Christians. So we have here the network, family network, associates. Okay, the Sufis explain a lot. They don't explain everything. Okay, now I have some more, but I'm going to give now a conversion narrative, and I think I'll conclude with that. Okay, and this is the new one. Okay. If we have time, I have another one, which probably maybe some of you know about. I've published it already. Okay. Anyway, now this is taken from Al-Nuwayri's Nihayat al-Arab fi Funun al-Adab. It's written in the first quarter, I say about 1320. Al-Nuwayri was an important Mamluk official in Syria and Egypt. He was Egyptian originally, but spent much of his career in Syria. He himself, when he gets to this, about half of this 33-volume book, by the way, a very nice compendium of translations, has just been published by Elias Mohana. In paperback in Penguin, so you can read a little bit from some of the other things about this 33, took about 250 pages from this 33 volumes, half of which is devoted to history, the other half is a very, very standard administrative encyclopedia, very important administrative encyclopedia. He devotes half a volume, volume 27, he devotes to the history of the Mongols, which is very, there are two examples of that, two examples of encyclopedias which devote a large chunk, 100 and some pages, to the Mongols, and one of them is Nuwayri. So he's talking about now, in the experience of Baiju. Baiju was the commander of the Mongol army in northwestern Iran before Hulagu showed up. And when Hulagu shows up, and the first thing he does is he sends him off to Anatolia, which has already been conquered by the Mongols, and says, you take your 30,000 troops and families, and you settle there, because I have my, I'm not exaggerating, 100,000 families, and we need Azerbaijan. So Baiju moves to the west. And there's an ongoing, a lot of tension in Anatolia in the middle and end of the 1250s, which I'm not going to go into. Now, this is the story that's told of Baiju's encounter with Islam and the possible result. Now, I got to say that some of what al-Nuraydi tells us, and Baiju's own experiences, I have no parallel. I have no authorization for that. I have no further proof of it. So it's kind of in the air. But so I think we're talking about here a kind of a later conversion narrative which has been floating around, and somehow it's gotten to Egypt or Syria, and Nuraydi puts it into his book. I may yet find some parallel in Persian or something, but this is what I. So after the defeat of the Seljuk Empire, this is this will become very briefly a direct citation. After the defeat of the Seljuk army in Rum, in Anatolia, near Konya, the Khatib, the preacher, and it's interesting, his name is not given. So he gathers all the notables of Konya together and says, "We've been defeated. The Mongols are going to come. We're in bad shape. They're going to turn the city upside down. They're going to kill people. They're going to steal things. We got to beat them at their game. I'm going to gather all the money, and we're going to bring all this money and good stuff to the Mongols ahead of time, and that way we're going to be able to prevent the attack of the city directly, the taking of the city, and everything that's going to happen." So he does that, and he sends ahead of time supplies and a gift. Baiju wasn't there, of course, at his camp. Baiju was out hunting. But he does go in and meet Mrs. Baiju. She's referred to as Al-Khatun, as the royal lady, if you wish, as the important lady. And so she gives him some food and drink, and here it's becoming a direct translation. The Khatib takes a taste of the food, but he takes no drink. So the Khatun asks him why he's not drinking. He says, "This is forbidden." And so she says, "Why is this forbidden?" He says, "God has forbidden it in our book." Obviously, they can't. The Mongols were big drinkers. The Mongols are still big drinkers. I mean, big drinkers, and I mean, they put the Russians into their small pocket. There's no. And nobody drinks like the Mongols. And nobody, if you're not a Mongol, it's very hard to keep up to. It's not a good thing to indulge in. But it says, "God has forbidden this in his book." And then she says, "Well, why is it not forbidden to us?" So he says, "You are infidels. Why, we are Muslims." And she says, "Well, who has more merit with God, you or us? You know, us the infidels, or you the Muslims?" And the Khatib says, "Actually, us. You know, we do." This is a dangerous conversation. Okay. The conversation continues, and the Khatib says, "Well, why did we? How did we defeated you?" To which he replies, "Well, the clothes upon you," and this, she was wearing a very expensive, valuable garment inlaid with pearls. "Do you give it to someone who is special to you, or someone who is far away from you, someone who is not important to you, if you wish?" And she said, "Certainly, I'll single out somebody who was important to me." And he says, "And if he ruined it, like if the guy you gave the gift to ruined it and abandoned it and polluted it, what would you do to him?" She said, I would make an example of him, that's a mistake, of him, and kill him." Now the Khatib then said, he says, "Well, the religion of Islam is like this valuable garment. I'm sure this is a topus that appears elsewhere. God honors us with it, but we did not behave as we should have towards. So God was angry with us, and he struck us with your swords and punished us with your hands." So this, to clean this up a little bit, but the wife of Baiju wept and said to the Khatib, "From now on you are my father, and I will be your daughter." And he said, "That is not possible until you convert to Islam." And she then was converted by him and sat him to her side on the couch. Now, Baiju returns from the hunt. The Khatib intended to get up for him, but the Khatun, Mrs. Baiju, said, prevented him and said, "You have become his father-in-law, and he will want to come to you and serve you." Then Baiju entered the tent, and she said to him, "This man has become my father." Baiju sat below him and honored him, saying to his wife, "I swore to God that when I conquered Konya, I would give it to you as a present." And she said, I have given it to my father. Then Baiju ordered that Konya would be open, guaranteeing the safety of his people, appointing a shakhna, or an official, at each gate. And this goes on and on about how good he was to Konya. Okay, now I just want to add, 30 pages later, he mentions, sort of by the way, that a year later at Baiju's death, he says he had converted to Islam before his death. It's not said in the previous, but it's implied, but here it's said explicitly. So this is a conversion narrative. I don't know how it got to Egypt. We might find parallels. I haven't found them yet. But I find it interesting. This is taking place. No Sufis. Who can be more official than a Khatib? Who can be more part of the establishment than a paid official who gives the sermon every week? So what I'm suggesting here is that we have Sufis, we have ulama, we have officials, we have Turks. There's a lot going on in greater Iran. And it's going to lead to eventually to conversion of the Mongols. I wish I could say more, but that's pretty much what I could say at this point. I have another story here from Nuwari, but I'll leave it for about, we'll leave it for another time, perhaps. Okay, and I just want to conclude with one. Okay, one second. Oh, I got all this stuff here. I'm going backwards, that's why. Okay, here we go. Okay. Now, just with the charismatic but challenging study of the Islamization of the Mongols. This is a beautiful picture. It's a really beautiful picture. When do we get to see grandpa, father, and son anywhere, let alone in Muslim art of the Middle Ages? We have grandpa Abaka, who's the ruling Khan. He's on the horse, he's wearing a crown. You'll see the Persian jitter, the pirate parasol, which is a sign of royal authority, together with the crown. We have the son, Dad Argun, who rules later from 1284 to 91. And then we have little baby Gaza in Dad's arms. A remarkable picture. It's beautiful. It's written in early 15th century, about 100 years after the composition of Rashid ad-Din's great historical work, Jami'at Tawarikh. But note carefully, not only is baby Ghazan wearing, who became a Muslim, is he wearing a turban, a sign of Islam. Dad Argun, who was a militant anti-Muslim Buddhist, He's also wearing a turban. So the artist couldn't, you know, this is obviously by 1500, the descendants of the Mongols have all become Turks, they've all become Muslims. It's an established fact, it's institutionalized. I guess it's not very pleasant to say that the founding father of this process, Ghazan, was born not a Muslim. In fact, he himself was a little bit of a Christian, he was a little bit of a Buddhist, and eventually he became a Muslim. And of course, shamanism is floating in the background too, and his father was even more so. But here they are portrayed with turbans, so history is being rewritten. Again, Islamization myths. So this is, it's also evocative, it's a beautiful picture. It's charming in a way, it's endearing in a way, but it also says how difficult it is to try to myth and as close as we're ever going to get the fact, so to speak. So thank you very much.
So thank you very much for a fascinating lecture. And we're going to start with the questions now. So I see Uri's hand. Uri, please.
So thank you very much. Actually, have a number of questions, but it's pretty much related to the same topic. And this is something that I know, I get the impression you're less interested in, but I'm very much interested in. And that is the obverse aspect of conversion to Islam, namely not what drove people into embracing a different religion, but once they had, what it actually entailed in terms of that new religion, of that civilization they were now part of. So the three related questions I want to put forth, and they are related to this broader issue, are first, the Mongols themselves, they have left behind them any literary corpus that can be, or is there any aspect of their culture that is also an intellectual one, aside from that their military achievements, mm-hmm. and their nomadic character? So that's one aspect of the issue. Second aspect is, can we assess, once they've converted, once they've become part of that Islam, whether things have become, whether we can identify Mongol aspects of Islam? Is there a Mongol Islam? Is there anything that entered into, say, the Mamluk culture, society, and so forth and so on, that we can say, oh, we can trace that from Central Asia, we can trace that from Southeast Asia, and so forth and so on? And thirdly, these narratives, from what I'm gathering, are mostly composed in the western part of Asia. They're in the Fertile Crescent, in Egypt, mm-hmm. under Mamluks, and they're telling the story of Mongols. I'm wondering whether these narratives are authored by people who are, say, detached from that previous Mongol phase, or are they in fact maybe related, maybe through family type, maybe they themselves, maybe they're descendants of Mongols themselves, and this is now reflecting the way they want to portray the process that eventually led to where they are once they're telling the story.
All right, we have an hour. Okay. First of all, regarding Mongol literary corpus, there is a great work in Mongolian written probably around 1240. I would even say it's one of the great works of world literature. It's called The Secret History of the Mongols. It has a long and interesting story how it was rediscovered in the 19th century. It was written in Chinese transliteration to Chinese characters, and that's it was reconstructed, so to speak. It had been lost. It was a secret, and they forgot about it, I guess. But it's a great work, and it tells the story of the rise of Genghis Khan, his career, and his immediate successors. It's clearly been edited and reflects some of the political concerns of the 1240s, 1250s. The Mongols, by the middle of the 1240s, the Mongol royal family is kind of at loggerheads, and it gets out of hand, and there's a lot of people lose their heads or die otherwise in the 1240s and 1250s, and that also may explain this sort of renewed energy of conquest for the Mongols that are going towards China. Kublai gets sent to China to continue conquest. Hulagu gets sent to southwestern Asia. You got to keep them busy. Got to keep the guys busy. Otherwise, things are going to fight each other. They're going to fight each other. But that's a great work, and it gives us an idea of life. We don't always have to take it literally. But it does give a sense of the ethos of the Mongols in the early. Now, Rashid ad-Din is a great historian. I mean, Rashid ad-Din is a world-class historian. He writes world history. He starts off with the Mongols and the Turks, but he ends up with France and goes to Southeastern Asia. And it has a nice chapter about the Jews, too. And as I said, he was a converted Jew, and he has evidently some biblical information that one doesn't generally find in the Muslim accounts of the Israeliyat. He also has a lot of information about the early Mongols. He evidently had another Mongol source that's been lost. So we have some idea of what the Mongols thought about their own history. Having said that, the number of Mongol documents that have been found in Iran, and there are some, can probably be counted on three hands. They're usually letters and orders and things like that. There's no work, no book, or even that was composed in Mongolian in Greater Iran under the Mongols. What we have is a very, very rich historiography in Persian and in Arabic, and that's becoming more and more clear. And that's one of the important things that Michal has been doing. Michal Biran is, you know, I've been working for 20 years on what is being said about the Mongols in Syria and Egypt. She found a lot of material, which I hadn't seen, some of it, but she found a lot of material that's appearing in Iraq, it's appearing in the Jazeera, it's appearing in elsewhere, in Arabic, that says a lot about the Mongols too. Now, some of this is written by Mongol officials working for the Mongols. Some of it is written by ulama. We got a book by a guy who was the librarian of the main library in Baghdad. And things weren't so bad in Baghdad after it was destroyed. The Mongols had made an effort. And that's the important thing, I think. The Mongols are great patrons. They're great patrons of learning, all kinds of learning, secular and religious. I have a paper called Hulagu and His Wise Men. I don't think this gave terrible satisfaction to somebody who saw his city destroyed, his family killed, the fields have been destroyed by the Mongol horses eating the crops. But the Mongols will set up a very large observatory, astronomical and astrological observatory, and it was like an ERC project. It was an ICOR. They set up an ICOR in northwestern Iran for Nasiruddin Tusi, and who didn't come from? They came from the Byzantine Empire. They came from Egypt and Syria. They came from all over. The Mongols were big patrons of culture, intellectual and material culture, and I think this goes back. It has its origins before the Mongols. This is part of what a Central Asian ruler does. It's a topos, but the topos influence is what actually gets done. So they move people, they move scholars from one side of Asia to the other, they move craftsmen from one side of Asia to the other. Chinese medicine and Chinese agriculture is influencing Iran, and vice versa. Philosophical inquiries. There was an atmosphere of, let's call it, relatively tolerant. And that's part of I could have mentioned that too. The Mongols were generally religiously tolerant. I mean, it kind of doesn't work. They say you either submit or we kill you. That's it. Those are the options. That's pretty much. It didn't take long to get an advanced degree in political science under the Mongols. And that was basically it. You submit unconditionally or we kill you. That was the rule. But at the same time, they said, we don't really care what you, you know, if you guys want to be Christians, that's okay. You want to be Jews, that's fine. We don't care. You want to be Buddhists? And they say, you know, some of the sources, the Islamic sources, kind of wondering what's going on. They can't really figure this out. They say, well, some of the Mongol kids have become Christians, and some of them become Muslims, and some of them become Buddhists. And then they say something very interesting. Some of them don't have any religion, which means they're remaining true to both the Christians and the Muslims can't comprehend this shamanism. They call it, they have no religion. Because it doesn't fit anything else. They can't even, Buddhism they understand. They call it, you know, the religion of Din al-Asnam, Din of idols. But they can't understand shamanism. So time and again, and interestingly enough, Ibn Fadlan even says that too in the 10th century when he looks at the Turks. He says, these guys don't have any religion. You know, it's not what we understand as religion. That's the Gabayan and Mongol aspects of Islam. Of course, Islam changes. First of all, Sufism is becoming strong. I mean, that's a phenomenon of the 13th century in general. Certainly among the Mamluks,
Sufism
is becoming stronger.
Strong.
It's becoming more institutionalized. We're seeing that also in Central Asia. We're seeing it in Southern Russia, among the Golden Horde. So that's one. There's a lot of theological, a lot of political thinking, political legitimacy is developing. Judith Pfeiffer is talking about this in depth, and she's looking at this very, very carefully. The Mongols are becoming Muslims, but they're influencing, you know, under their aegis, Islam is also changing. You cannot understand the history of Iran and the surrounding countries without taking into account what the Mongols left us. Certainly political legitimization under the Ottomans for centuries and the role of secular law or non-religious law or siyasi or kanuni justice and things like that may have their origins under the Mamluks too, or certainly were strengthened by the Mamluks. There is an ongoing discussion about how did the Mamluks affect the Mamluks. I alone wrote a long series of papers about this. I think he's generally right. Some people associated certain importance, but the fact that the Mamluks are fighting the Mongols all the time and they have to, everything they do, the Mongols are taken, and I think correctly so, as an existential danger to the Mamluks. The Crusaders were a problem. They were a pain in the neck, but they weren't an existential danger. Where the Mongols were, and you can't understand the Mamluks without taking that into account. Did they affect them otherwise? There were some Mongol immigrants, they may have affected it. You know, there were some, I have a paper from way back too called Mamluks of Mongol Origin. So that's an interesting point. Kobi Yosef from Bar Ilan has been writing about that too. He doesn't fully agree with me. So it's good to have somebody to disagree with, you know, as kind of a orphan. Now I have some people to talk to. That's an ongoing discussion too. What is the role of the people of Mongol origin in the Mamluk Sultanate? The people writing in history are a mixed lot. I'll just give you a couple examples. I'll give you three examples from the Mamluks, just to put things. So we have Nuwairi, who's a high official, but he's hanging out with the Mamluks. So I wouldn't be surprised if he knew some Turkish. We have two stories that he tells. One of the great things about this medieval Islamic history is when the historian puts himself into the story. You know, so he tells a story of sitting around the campfire the night before a big battle with the Mongols. You know, the guys are, you know, a little bit afraid, maybe a lot afraid, and they're kind of talking about that. And he talks about trying to convince a Mamluk officer not to flee, not to desert to the Mongols a little bit later because of internal Mamluk policies. So he knew what he was talking about in that sense. Al-Umri, Ibn Fadl al-Umri, who writes a generation later, another great encyclopedia, another 30-volume encyclopedia, has half a volume devoted to the Mongols, which was edited by Klaus Lech, 1968. It's a both remarkable edition, you know, just like a typical German work, 120 pages of Arabic, 100 pages of translation, and 350 pages of notes. So it's a remarkable work, exemplar of philological scholarship. So what's interesting about him is he gives all of his informants who fled as the Ilkhanate collapses in around 1935. So he has all these people coming over, including, and they're translating Persian for him too. So he's, again, a high official who knows what's up, knows how things work in the center of the things. He's not a Mamluk.
These are converts?
No, even for that's an old...
No, the people who translate for him.
No. These are Iranians, scholars, and bureaucrats who have been working for the Mongols. And their families have been working for the Mongols for generations. And some of them grew up in the Ordu, in the camp. I wouldn't be surprised if some of them also knew Turkish and Mongolian. I have no doubt that Rashiduddin knew Mongolian and Turkish. Juvayni is an earlier historian, also a family whose father had very early made peace with the Mongols. Him and his brother are major officials. He's the governor of Baghdad, and his brother is the wazir. I mean, these are important guys. And they grew up, they spent part of their youth in Mongolia. In the 1240s, they were in Mongolia. So they probably knew Mongolian too. They knew. Now, the last character is a guy named Ibn al-Dawudari. Some of you may know his name. He's a particularly not important historian. No one ever cites him. There's one, the manuscript in several volumes has come down to us, but it's clear, nobody ever read it. He was like a third-rate official. Both his grandfathers were important Mamluk officials, but he's, you know, and not a ne'er-do-well, but he just never made it very important. He's so much wants the Sultan to pay attention to him, and it's clear the Sultan never paid attention to him. Nasser Muhammad Ibn Kaloum, very interesting. But he knows his stuff, that's the thing. He grew up, he's 100% Turk in terms of all his grandfathers and grandmothers. He knew Turkish. He has remarkable information about the Mongols, and he tells us a story which is just like, I get, you know, every time I read it, I get, you know, excited. A bunch of us sit around and we read Turkish folklore together, okay? Including a couple important Mamluks themselves, including the great man about town and writer Ibn Daniyal, who some of you know, who was an interesting story in itself. He's a poet and playwright, he wrote shadow plays, he was a doctor, eye doctor, and again, a bon vivant, he was kind of manner, I get, you know, writes wine poetry too, a really important guy too. So they're all part of this group, studying Turkish folklore and Mongolian folklore, and he writes the history. He writes, he has a 20-page, he gives in Arabic, a 20-page, I don't know if it's a précis or it's the whole thing, but he gives this book, and he has like 5 pages devoted to the Turks and 5 pages devoted to the Mongols, and it doesn't fit anything else we know about the Mongols too. So this is what was working in, this is what was floating around Cairo in the early 14th century. So a lot of work yet to be done. A lot of work, and we made progress. We made great progress, and of course we made progress because of what other people did, and there's an interesting dialogue between different scholars, but there's a lot of work yet to do.
Uwe.
I'd like to draw on part of your first response to Uwe about how some of the kids were set to convert to Judaism from Christianity. So it's kind of the low.
I said Islam and Christianity. I didn't say Judaism. I can talk about that too, though.
Okay, so what I mean, the point here for me is how there is a topos perhaps of people observing the Mongols and sensing how low the stakes are for them in terms of choosing which religion to convert to. So I'm thinking about, say, William of Rubric's narrative. And there's this...
What narrative? I'm sorry, I didn't hear.
William of Rubric.
Okay.
Right? There's this wonderful scene towards the end where he sets up the disputation at the Ilkhanate court. And he speaks on behalf of Latin Christianity, but there's a Nestorian, and there's a Muslim, I think, and there's a Buddhist. And the way he sets it up is not, I mean, one would think that what we have here is a kind of a vision of the ruler as a patron of abstract contemplation of which religion is the best, but that's not the way I read it, at least. What is at stake here is a pressing question of who the Mongols are going to become very soon. They have to choose, right? So, I mean, the debate is which religion, you know, emerges as triumphant, which is which religion the Mongols are going to convert to. Now, even if that is not, certainly that is not a vision espoused by the Mongols, it seems to me that that was at least a myth that was upheld by many people who were looking at them. So, to begin with, William Rubric embarks on this mission because of the false rumor that, to begin with, they already converted to Christianity. And there's kind of a lot of voices, rumors about them being Jews or Christians or all kinds of things, and that ties on to Prester John, all kinds of kind of traditions around them. Now that's odd, it seems. I mean, it has to play a role in how we think about their conversion, because when we think about the conversion, say, of kind of people, say Iberia, we as historians can observe that it is likely that over the course of centuries, a population will assimilate to or adopt the religion of the rulers. But we don't assume that there's kind of there's an imminent sense in which they have to become something. They do over the course of a time. Whereas the people who were looking at Mongols for decades were thinking they are going to become something very soon. They're Christians. They're not going to stay the same. That's noteworthy, it seems to me. That's odd.
Thank you. That was actually an interesting sort of set of questions, or two, three questions. First of all, there is an example, an interesting example of a invading people taking on the religion of and the culture of those who they invaded. I can think of two. Normans are one. Of course, the Norsemen become Normans and become Christians and French speakers very quickly. And the Bulgarians, who were Turks from the Volga, one group of them went west to the Balkans and became Slavified and Christianized also fairly quickly. So that can happen. It can happen. It's just a bigger example of, and of course, perhaps I should have emphasized that in the West, in what's today Uzbekistan, Kazakhstan, Kyrgyzstan, in Iran, Greater Iran, and in southern Russia and Ukraine, those three large groups of Mongols became Muslims eventually, Turkified and Muslims. Whereas in the East, eventually they became Tibetan Buddhist in Mongolia, in China. And one can actually say where the Mongols became Tibetan Buddhists, they stayed Mongols, and where they became Muslims, they became Turks, or vice versa. But there is that interesting distinction. And wherever you find Mongol speakers, whether they're the Kalmyks in the Volga River today, the Boyrats in Burats in Lake Baikal, the various Mongol groups in China, basically they're all Tibetan Buddhists. So that's an interesting process too. That's kind of the background to it. Now, I think the Mongols, They broke the mold in a sense. That nobody knew what to do with them. Nobody knew what to do. They were so, first of all, they appeared relatively quickly. They were really destructive. They could, some of the Muslim writers say correct or almost correctly say they're like the Turks, or they're Turks, which is kind of more or less correct. It's not completely wrong. We hear reports in the Arabic and Persian sources that the Mongols will say to a group of Turks, join us. What are you doing hanging out with the Russians? When you should join us, we're from the same min jins wahid. We're from the same jins. We're from the same race, if you wish. Okay? And that means we're the people of Central Asia. The people of Central Asia have a lot in common no matter what language they speak. Okay? But there's a tremendous amount of cognitive dissonance, I have no other word for it, just pre-confusion. You see what's going on in Europe, you see, again, I don't study this detail, and I've, been reading sources a little bit, but I've mainly reading modern works on what was going on, and they're trying to figure out what's going on, and part of it is maybe the Jews are connected. Maybe the Jews, in some places, Israel Yuval wrote about this, and Sophie Manasseh wrote about this, and, some Jews may have actually been excited and thought, well, here we are, the 10 tribes, at least one of them is coming back, and we're helping. And Jews are accused of collecting weapons for the Mongols, and, being a fifth column, if you wish. And this is an interesting topos in itself, the Jews as people of the East, and go on and on about that, too, and I'm sure plenty of people here have things to say about that. Another example of Jews as people of the East, anti-Christians, basically. Now, what do the Mongols themselves actually think about this? What are they? There's no doubt about this Prester John business, these rumors reaching, trying to make sense of it. I don't think the Mongols were sitting there saying, okay, now that we're a big empire, let's become monotheists. I don't think that's happening. I don't think it's happening. Not happening under Chinggis Khan. It's not happening under Monke. Before I continue, the idea of a nomadic ruler having a symposium in front of him, among other things, talking about religious matters, is a topos too. I think it's a topos, but topos can also, we do things because of topoi also. Somebody's going to come along someday and look at the Knesset building and say, we'll hear about the Knesset building and say, they couldn't have had 120 seats in the Knesset. That's a topos. Okay? Well, it's a topos that influenced the way people actually did something. So I think that theme comes up again and again. The part of what a nomadic ruler does, any nomadic ruler, self-respecting nomadic ruler, is surround himself with wise men and listen to. And I certainly found examples around Hulagu. A couple of them are stories, I have no doubt about, including Jews. The Jews are involved in this too. The Jews appear too in more than one place. They're probably stories, but I think the stories reflecting a reality. And the fact is, the Mongols did surround themselves with scholars of various types, secular and otherwise. Giovanni, the governor of Baghdad and the great historian, one of the three or four great historians of the Mongols in his History of the World Conqueror, He first of all, he ends his book very conveniently. He ends his book talking about how what a great thing the Mongols did for Islam by destroying the assassins, by destroying the Ismailis, and then the book stops about a month before the taking of Baghdad, which is very clear that he couldn't deal with it. He didn't want to deal with it. Rashida Dinh, writing two generations later, has no problems dealing with that. Now, Giovanni also writes that the Islam is spreading under the Mongols. Is that wishful thinking? Is that reflecting reality? I think it's probably somewhere in between. Okay, everybody wants the Mongols to convert. Everybody expects the Mongols to convert. The Buddhists obviously were counting on it. Didn't work out, but they were counting on it. The Christians of various types too. There are the Catholics on one hand, and the Eastern Christians on the other, and of course the Muslims of various types. What were the Mongols thinking in 1250? I don't think they were thinking about that. I think that they didn't see it was a problem. They didn't see there was a contradiction between being a shamanist and being loyal to Genghis Khan, the legacy of Genghis Khan, and becoming anything else. I think they were just, I don't want to say they were going with the flow. Maybe they weren't going with the flow. It didn't concern them. It didn't seem to concern them. Of course, having become Muslims, two generations, three generations later, they're going to have to look at things differently, because Islam is more obligating, more demanding, and there are going to be lots of stories that are floating around of Muslims. How did the Muslims convert? And what did Genghis? The story I didn't read, which is also floating around Cairo at the beginning of the 14th century, written down by Nuwairi, where Genghis Khan, Nuwairi claims, I have no idea where the story comes from. I have no idea. I've looked. He claims that Genghis Khan had a Jewish teacher. He ran into a Jew in Mongolia, and he said, how am I going to be like, get ready for this, how am I going to be like Musa, Isa, and Muhammad? Okay? And the guy says, we see in our books. We see in our books that you're going to be a great man. Our books. What, the Torah, the Talmud, Pirkei Avot? I don't know. On the one hand. And then he says, if you want to be great like these guys, you have to be an ascetic. You have to, there's a Sufi, a little bit of Sufism here too. There's monotheism here. You have to, and live by yourself and dedicate yourself to God. And then he says, this is the end of the little chapter, he says, and that's how Genghis Khan got his start. And Genghis Khan also had shamanistic elements too in his life. So there's a lot floating around and not always clear what's historical and what's story. You know, when he writes about Sheikh Ali, the Oyurat, showing up, I have no doubt that was a real story. I have no doubt it's a real story. Baiba Zamantui was a young Mamluk. He's writing it down when he's a little bit older. He was a witness. He was one of Kalaun's Mamluks. I have no doubt that that's a real story. But on the other hand, when talking about, I'm really very skeptical that Genghis Khan ran into a Jewish teacher in Mongolia. They get around, but they don't get around that much. And, you know, by the way, one of my colleagues, after he saw the article, did Genghis Khan have a Jewish teacher? He said, your next article should be, did Genghis Khan have a Jewish mother? And that would explain a lot. But that's another
thing. Daniela?
She left?
Left.
Yeah, I, being pretty ignorant of all this period and places, I'm just curious about the terminology. All these terms are ethnic terminology, linguistic terminology, political terminology. In other words, what is the identity here that we're talking about? How do these groups see themselves? You mentioned that Central Asians are all the same race. So, Jinza. So the question is, what is it? A linguistic? Is it ethnic? Is it genetic? Is it national?
I don't think it's genetic. I don't think it's genetic at all. I don't think anybody was thinking those terms. Listen, that's a big challenge. A big challenge is to think about ethnicity in the Middle Ages, in the pre-modern period. I mean, that's only kept a zillion people busy in the last generation or two. You know, and that's an example. Nobody talks about the Turks and the Mongols in the Middle Ages. No, not Smith and not Hobsbawm and not Gilner and not anybody else. I mean, they had other fish to fry, but it's another set of issues, just like it's a set of issues to talk about Arab ethnicity. And we had something interesting to say today about, we already had something about another new source that talks about Arab ethnicity that I hadn't heard about, a new study, Iranian identity. That's a whole, you know, I didn't touch upon that at all. There's a lot of resurgence of Iranian identity to the Mongols. Now the question is, were the Mongols involved in any way? Did that concern them in any way? I don't think they did, but it's clear that a lot of people working with the Mongols, a lot of these bureaucrats who, you know, they had day jobs as bureaucrats and wrote history and philosophy at night.
Is Iranian a geographical term, a linguistic term?
Both, all of the above. Okay? It's Iran Zamin, land of Iran. It's Persian, Persophonia, if you wish, and it's people who connected that. But this is a big challenge. Oh, I'll give another example. When a bunch of Mongols show up, and they become Mamluks various ways, and then they rebel, and they talk about jinsia. Jinsia, the word jins, using race, is not a good word. Jins today, of course, means sex, and both in the sense of gender and the actual sexual act. So it's very complicated. Obviously, what are they talking about when they say jins? You know, how do we define that? That could be a nice project. That would be a very nice MA thesis on its own. But let's, for lack of a better term, people of the same type, people who see, you know, for lack of a better term, of same some type of ethnic solidarity. Jinsia is some ethnic solidarity. They do things because of jinsia. The Mongols, Mamluks of Mongol origin, some of them at least, had a sense of ethnic solidarity and were, on the basis of that, rebelling against other Mamluks. So it's very confusing. I try to be careful. I try not to overextend myself. I certainly am talking about modern nationalism. But there is a sense of ethnic solidarity. There is certainly, I'll define it differently, there certainly is a sense that people of the steppe who come from the pastoral nomadic background are different from everybody else and better. And they're the people who count.
Is it physiological?
I think it's lifestyle. I think it's a sense of common origin. I think it's speaking new languages. But it also, one gets a sense that even Armenians can be called Tatar. Of course, they're working for the Mongols. So we got to be very, very careful. I don't want to say there's no ethnicity. There's obviously some ethnicity. It's clearly not modern nationalism. Nobody's talking about the right of self-determination of the Mongol peoples or something like that in modern terminology. But there is some ethnicity there. There is sense of the word jinsia can only be understood as some sense of ethnic solidarity. I have no other way to get around it. At least it's used sometimes. And by the way, just one more thing. When the Mongols are defeated by the Mamluks at the Battle of Enjolut here in Israel, up north, by Mayan Harod in 1260, one of the Arab writers writing in Syria right afterwards, you know, in real time, he's a witness, he was in Damascus at this time, he says the reason that the Mamluks were successful because they're from the same jinns. Okay, they're from the same, whatever, ethnicity, type, race, lifestyle, certainly meaning, what I understand is to mean basically they shoot arrows the same way. They ride on horses and shoot arrows the same way.
Let me just add to this that I think that there's a lot of attention paid to the question of ethnic background. First of all, we have Jahaz's work on the Turks, as identifying them as a group and talking about their physiological traits and talking about the way that they are raised and so on and educated. But then there's also even Saad al-Andalusi, am I saying, is that right? The guy from Andalusia in the 10th century who writes about the different groups of the world. These are basically different ethnic groups, very heavily influenced by the questions of weather and where you are on the globe, in terms of how much sunshine you have absorbed and so on, and talking about different features. So obviously it's not nationalism, as you're saying, but there is an awareness of ethnic background, that's for sure. Guido.
May I just add something? Also, the Persians had an ethnic division, but it's not climatological, it's aesthetic, and where people live. They actually made a flower with Persia in the middle, and each petal is a different ethnicity.
That goes back, of course, before Islam.
Yeah?
Yep.
I wanted to ask about the axiom that you were challenging about Sufis and shamans.
Mm-hmm. Glad you brought that up.
Coaxy, what?
Glad you brought that
up.
Yeah.
You promised, so. What I know from the conversion of Mongols and of other nomadic peoples in northern mm-hmm. China to Buddhism, is mm-hmm. when the Buddhist missionaries came to those areas, it wasn't about theology or annihilation. It was about power and about miracle making. And the successful missionaries were documented miracle makers. So can there be a connection in that sense, that Sufis, in the sense of people who are able to activate the miracle world, or that kind of connection with the divine?
That's a very good point. And first of all, put it in the Middle Eastern context and perhaps go back to East Asia too. There's no doubt about it that this subject of miracles is comes up in retrospect, certainly. In retrospect. I don't know. You know, we have the text that Devin DeWeese worked on for the Golden Horde, for the conversion of Uzbek in 1312. Now, this is written several generations later. So, I wasn't there, and I don't think anybody was there to take things down, you know. Wasn't Sheikh Ali showing up in the Mamdu court and someone says, look who's here, running it down. But the story is, of course, that they both went into, they were put in ovens. They had trial by fire. And the shaman gets fried and the Sheikh, what is it, Babla Tuklis or something, he comes out like, oh, that was a little hot, you know. It was clearly that they're better at miracles too. That's part of it. But again, that may be retrospect. I don't know if that's happening in real time, if that's what people are thinking in real time. That's part of it. Obviously, Sufis, it's much more complicated. Just like, listen, we're learning that Sufism is not only about, you know, a warm, but it's part of it, warm relation to religion, deep experience. It's about property. You know, Sufi orders having a lot of property. We know about that. It's about Sufis coming in and breaking up churches. We know a lot about that in Egypt and Syria, Palestine, during the Mamluks. More than once, coming in, killing the abbot of a monastery. Tough guys. It's also about miracles. So there's a lot going on. Sufism has a lot going on about it. That's not just spirituality. It's not everybody sitting around hugging each other and, you know, and all we're saying is give peace a chance type thing. So that's part of it. That's part of it. But there are fundamental differences. And the fact is, the shamans are still around. They haven't gone anywhere. You know? So, and of course, does that explain if shamanism is what appeals to them? Why does it? I mean, Sufism has an important role to play in Islamization. It had an important role to play in Anatolia. Had an important role to play in southern Russia. I mean, way beyond Turkish populations. So I think the shamanistic bit has been exaggerated greatly. I know where it comes from. It's Koprolu. Koprolu was a great historian. He was a great historian. And he was a pioneer. But he made a mishmash, everything from 10th century Central Asia to 14th century Anatolia and everything in between. And what he's doing is reading back roles of Sufis in general. The roles of Sufis in general to 10th century Central Asia, as the Turks are just about to start rolling in as tribes. Well, I want to say unconditionally, and I challenge anybody here to say differently, I have not found, and nobody else has found, any Sufis in Central Asia in the 10th century, period. What we do find are lots of traders, lots of Muslim traders. We find occasional ulama of various types. We find an occasional renegade officer from the Samanids who seem to have some impact. Not in the contemporary stories and not in the later. Ibn Fadlan, who's a contemporary story, he's writing things as he's going along. And he's coming back, and it's 923. He's working his way through the various tribes until he gets to the Bulgars. And then he's going to hear about the Khuzari, about the Khazars. What's important, and he has important information about the Vikings. I mean, what's not in this 60-page book? But he's writing, he's an ethnographer. And he's just as these tribesmen are their first, like the second day of, they've just now encountered Islam, encountered Muslims. They're asking questions. They're making fun. They're mimicking. Okay? No Sufis around, and first of all, they're not mentioned. Second, they're not mentioned anywhere. So it's all become kind of a mishmash. This is what Koprolu did. He did a methodological mishmash, so to speak. In 13th century Iran, was that the case? I don't get that. I don't have any sense of it. But you are right in the sense that they all, among the things that they can do, they have miracles. They have miracles, and they're successful. The miracles are successful. That's part of the deal.
So would you say, just to add a little, would you say the same thing about the conversion, the eventual conversion of the Mongols to Tibet?
Okay, I wanted to get to that too. That's actually, have you actually, well, that's something that's going on too. There is question now, among some of the new generation of, you know, I'm not a Mongolist. I don't sit and read Mongolian. I know a little bit of Mongolian. I studied a little bit, but I have no pretense of being a Mongolist. And I certainly don't work on 16th century, 17th century Mongolia for all kinds of reasons. I like visiting Mongolia, but I never got really excited about Buddhism, I confess. That just never doesn't catch me the same way as this stuff does. What I'm reading now is that some of the people working on this stuff now are beginning to question that paradigm also, that scheme also. They're not so sure. Now, there's no doubt about it. When the Buddha showed up, the Tibetan, and this is the second wave of Tibetan Buddhism, because the first wave was under Kublai, and second wave, there's a lot of pushing and shoving, and it wasn't all, again, hugging and trying to convince, in the symposium in front of the Khan, he said, why didn't I think of that before? Good idea, type thing. It's much more complex. It's very, very interesting stuff. It may be also, there are people who are wondering how much shamanism is involved in that stuff, too. I that's not my area of expertise. I should know more about it, but there's a lot of discussion about that going on in the East, too. Be it under the Mongols per se, the Mongol Empire, or be it under the post-empire Mongols in Mongolia in the 16th, 17th century. No doubt about it, Buddhism is there to stay. The connection between Tibetan Buddhism, the Tibetans and the Mongols is, the Dalai Lama, the word Dalai is a Mongolian word for ocean, meaning universal teacher. There have been Dalai Lamas who've been Mongols and vice versa, all kinds of things, a lot of moving. And they're both in terrible shape considering who their neighbor is.
First of all, thank you very much. And I would like to draw you into one of the sources you were presenting. The one discussing the conversion of a group of youths.
Yeah.
Is that indicative of maybe the target of Sufi preachers? Are they targeted at youth? To what extent are youth a part of this issue of conversion? Is it something that you can say something about, or is it just happenstance?
It's a remarkable piece of information. It's written by somebody who doesn't like the Mongols. It's written by somebody who saw it as his own eyes as a young officer. Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's no reason for him to say anything good about it, except that these guys have converted, which is good from his eye. And then, of course, as I said, they evidently have some moral turpitude, which is not detailed, but the Sultan throws them all into jail, and that they rot in jail, basically. If I had an organized effort to convert somebody or to convince somebody, I would go for the young people. That makes sense. I mean, rather than the old guys, makes sense. It's a great story. It's a story. It's like a peg. It's like a peg you put on the wall. It's just you put the picture on it. But how many pictures? What does it say? What's in the picture? I don't know yet. We don't know yet. It's an important piece of information, and it's probably true, as far as it goes. But it doesn't say enough. We'll keep it up. We'll just keep reading, and we'll find more evidence as we come by. And it's not like somebody said, I'm going to write a book about the conversion of the Mongols. It's all there and written in real time by an impartial observer. The ethnography department of the University of Baghdad, for some reason, didn't take this on. They didn't get their ISF. I don't know, the Iraqi Science Foundation. I don't know. We don't have information. But whatever information we have, it's better than we have for the Turks in the 10th century.
I want to follow up on Gideon's question and ask to be a little bit more specific about one aspect that came up here. Basically, you presented a picture of a lot more bottom-up than top-down than we thought. A. B, you're saying that you don't know of any Sufis in the 10th century, but actually, there weren't many Sufis at all in
That's
the 10th
century. That's part of the point. That's part of the point.
If you move on to the 12th century and so on, you probably will come across a different situation. And here is my question. If we talk about bottom-up conversion, it means that the average Mongol or Turk were converting without their leaders. They were doing it independently. Who was the agent converting them? Well, and if it happens in the 11th and 12th century, we are talking about a much larger presence of Sufis. So I want to sort of revisit this question of Sufism, and I want to hear from you a little bit more specifically what you think about it, not in the 10th century, but in the 12th or 13th.
Okay, first of all, fine. There's a difference between the 12th and 13th century. there are no Mongols in the 12th century. They come in 1219. That's when they come. They pay their first visit to the Middle East.
Talking about them moving into the steppe.
Okay. Well, the Mongols were in the eastern steppe. Mongolia is far away. You know, there may be. I haven't looked into this, frankly. I would not be surprised. You know, you look at the Karakhanids. You look at the Karakhanids were a well-established Muslim regime, and they also tried in their own way to be establishment Muslims, you know, mainstream Muslims. There's nothing sectarian about them. You know, I remember Ayalon saying this in like 1981 or 1982, and he says, think about Mahmoud Kashgari, the guy who wrote the dictionary, the great dictionary, the Turkish English, the Turkish Arabic dictionary, in Baghdad in the 11th century. Think about this guy. He comes from Kashgar. Kashgar is Western China. Kashgar is pretty far away. And so this is, he comes, now when did, he said, where did he learn Arabic so well? And where did this guy write this beautiful dictionary that's so organized, such an important work? It tells about the language, and talks about the folklore, and talks about the history, and it's in a, and the Arabic part is really, really good Arabic. So he says, perhaps even in Kashgar, there was already centers of Arabic learning. Or he had a start, and then he moved further west and came into the Arabic-speaking world, the Islamic world. So I think that things changed dramatically in the 12th century, and I have not investigated in the Middle East. I have nothing to say of substance beyond what I've read in some of the scholarly works. That's an interesting subject. The Kara, you know, again, Michal Biran has done basic investigative work, and she's written also the article in Encyclopedia Iranica on the Karakhanids. There are a lot of questions there about conversion too, but it's clear that they're already, this is a kind of a run-up. This isn't, you know, this is Karakhanids in some way set the stage for the Seljuks, in some way. An establishment, Turkish nomads ruling Muslim sedentary civilization on the margins. So that's with regard to the 12th century. I don't think anybody got as far as Mongolia. Mongolia was really terra incognita for the Muslims in the 12th, 13th century. It was really. I have a paper I never published about the Mongols, the early Mongols in Islam, and there are some very early examples of them encountering traders and things like that. But it's already after the first stages of expansion and everything like that. I don't think there were any Muslims in Mongolia in that what we today call Mongolia in before the time of Genghis Khan. Mm-hmm. That's my sense. But Sufis, traders, you name it, rabbis, you name it.
Any more questions? Okay, so thank you very much.
My pleasure.